Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the virtual church on this day of Pentecost. That's a celebratory time in our calendar. We only do this once a year, you know. Pentecost only comes once a year in the third month of the year of the Hebrew calendar. And so we pause during this time and remember the significance of this day, the mighty things that have happened on it in time past, and what it signifies for us. And also we look forward. You know, we are in the age of Pentecost. If we're looking for ages or put a label on where we're living, we all kind of like to know where we fit, where we are in the scheme of things. And we're in the age of Pentecost. That was the last big event on God's calendar. That's the time of first fruits. In fact, Pentecost is the Feast of Weeks. Why the Feast of Weeks? Well, because they're counting 7 weeks from the Passover, which, of course, we know was deliverance from Egypt, forgiveness of sin, and the death, resurrection, and exaltation of Jesus Christ. But then following time came Pentecost. As I mentioned, it's called the Harvest Festival, the Early Harvest. It's called the Feast of Weeks because they're counting 7 weeks. It's also called the Feast of First Fruits because it was the smaller early harvest. And in that semi-tropical climate of the Middle East, they were able to nurse out two harvests, an early spring a wheat harvest and then a later harvest, which is the big fall harvest. That's when the grapes and the fruit and all the bigger crops came in. So this is the smaller harvest, but it's a harvest nevertheless. It's called the Feast of First Fruits. And, well, Pentecost, where does that come from? Well, Pentecost is part of this counting, this Feast of Weeks, 7 weeks. That's 49 days, right, plus one. Because it was the morrow after. So that's the 50th. That's why it always comes out on a Sunday. So it's 50 days, count 50. And so we celebrate the Feast of Pentecost, and we're counting. And God wants us to be counting. He wants us to be aware of what's happening. Time is moving on. So we're in the age of Pentecost, the age of first fruits. In fact, our identity in the plan of God is that of first fruits. We're going to be the first fruits in the first resurrection, the first fruits of the dead following Jesus. And that's a privileged position. It's called the bride of Christ. It's early on. And then comes the great fall harvest. That's what's up next. And I suspect it's coming fairly soon. My, it's been 2,000 years we've been in the age of Pentecost. I believe it's nearing its close. And we're entering the time soon of the great fall harvest, the climax of the first phase, let's say, of God's grand plan. So we're doing this with a purpose in mind, and we're pausing because we know what this day means, what it signifies, and that God wants us to rest. He calls it a Sabbath, a time when we can pause and consider what he is doing. And we're going to have some help in that today. We've got our dear friend all the way from Ohio speaking to us, Dr. Doug Ward. How you doing, Doug?
Hi, just fine, Ken.
Oh, good. I'm just testing my microphone here, putting it over close to the phone, make sure we can hear you all right. How is Sherry doing, your dear wife?
Oh, let's see. We're having some difficulty with some nutritional issues. She had a gastric bypass surgery about 7 years ago, and after one of those, you have to be careful about getting enough nutrients.
Right.
So she's having some trouble right now with anemia.
Oh yeah.
But we're working on that.
Okay. Yeah. It is a struggle, and we know about that, and May God bless her and give her the nutrition she needs. And you do have to be especially careful because you're eating such small amounts.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And now, you've got, what was it, two children? I've forgotten.
Four.
Four, okay. And what are the names, Doug?
Oh, yeah, our oldest son is Timothy. He's almost 29 now.
Wow.
Rebecca is 26, and Andrew is 23, and Emily's 15.
And Emily, 15?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's the only one still at home.
Well,
now.
That's the one. That's the one I met when we were back there in Ohio, right?
Let's see. Yes. Uh-huh. Yep.
Okay. Yeah. Well. Yeah, I remember that. That well. Did you go with us to the Amish dinner? It seems like you did, right?
Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
And that was with Mel and Enos Hershberger. You know, Mel died Friday morning.
Oh, no, I hadn't heard that.
Yeah, he died. He knew he was very sick, and they told him that this would be his last summer if he made it. He didn't quite make it. But for those of you listening, Mel and Enos Hershberger of the Amish clans there in Ohio around Akron, and they no longer were members of the Amish or Plain People community, but most of the family still were. And so they arranged for us to go to his mother's place for an old-fashioned Amish meal, and cooked on wood stoves, no electricity anywhere. It was very interesting. I certainly enjoyed it. The food was good, too, wasn't it?
That was a good occasion. Yeah.
Yeah. So he died.
7 years now.
Yeah, yeah, right, 8 years or so. He died peacefully with his family at his side. So we certainly miss him. He was a good man. Well, before we begin our service today, we'll ask God's blessing upon us. Join me in prayer. Father, which art in heaven, great God, the mighty one, the one who thunders and shakes mountains, who comes down in a pillar of fire and speaks to your beloved people. And your beloved people listen to you because we need your instruction. We need your Torah. And Father, this day pictures the giving of that guidance, the giving of the Torah, and the giving of the Spirit, the power that comes from you to walk that path, to internalize and write in our hearts your Torah, your word, which implies your instructions, your laws, your character, your wisdom. So we ask your blessing now as we strive to learn more about you and what you've done with your people historically, how you're still working with us, you're still active in this world, you're dynamic, in your hands-on, dealing with your first fruits, your church, molding us into the very image of your glorious Son. So we ask your blessing now as we study your word. Inspire our main speaker, Dr. Ward. Give him words that will lift us up, will help us better understand your word. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Dr. Ward's message, and I'll have his picture behind me here. I'll zero in on it and move out of the way. Is going to be on the subject of what happens to Paul after the book of Acts ends. It doesn't tie things up. We like conclusions, right? We like to find out the end of the story, you know, what happened. But it doesn't go that far. Does that mean the story ends there? No, the story continues. We just don't have any more material. And that's true with a lot of what God's doing. It's going. It's going on. Someday I'm sure we'll get all the facts. That'll be fun. But the title of his message is What Happened to Paul After Acts 28. At least that's the title of his paper that you can also get that follows along with this. You can go to his website, Grace and Knowledge. www.faithweb.com, and there it'll be listed. Is there a better place to find it than that, Doug?
No, that's good. Yeah, and you can just you can click on issue 27, which is the current one, and it'll be right there.
Okay. Well, for this message today, on the day of Pentecost, Dr. Doug Ward from Oxford, Ohio. Go ahead, Doug.
Thanks, Ken. And again, it's a delight to be getting together with everybody on Festival Day again. We're all with one accord in lots of geographical places, but one spiritual place. And of course, today we do turn to the Book of Acts, where we read about how the disciples of Jesus, 7 weeks after Jesus' resurrection, are empowered with the Holy Spirit, and they proceed to announce the good news of the kingdom of God all over the Greco-Roman world. Everywhere they go, lives are transformed. And one prominent example, of course, is Saul of Tarsus, who initially persecuted the followers of Jesus, but Jesus had other plans for him. And Paul did a complete turnaround and became a leading apostle of Jesus. Jesus mentioned the plans he had for Paul in Acts 9, verse 15. And there, Jesus says, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings, and before the people of Israel." And when we reach the end of the book of Acts, Paul is reaching one of those goals. He's going to take the gospel before kings, before the big king, the Caesar in Rome. And so that's where I'd like to go now, to Acts chapter 28. And I'm going to read from verse 16 to the end of the chapter. Got a couple copies of the New International Version sitting on my computer screen that I'll be using. And so let's go to the end of the book, but not the end of the story. Acts 28 and verse 16. So at this point, Paul has just arrived in Rome as a prisoner. And in verse 16 it says, "When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him." And of course, the one who's writing is Paul's companion Luke. 3 days later, he called together the leaders of the Jews. When they'd assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I've done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. But when the Jews objected, I was compelled to appeal to Caesar, not that I had any charge to bring against my own people. For this reason, I've asked to see you and talk with you. It's because of the hope of Israel that I'm bound with this chain." They replied, "We've not received any letters from Judea concerning you, and none of the brothers who've come from there has reported or said anything bad about you. But we want to hear what your views are, for we know that people everywhere are talking against this sect." They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day, and came in even larger numbers to the place where he was staying. From morning till evening, he explained and declared to them the kingdom of God, and tried to convince them about Jesus from the law of Moses and from the prophets. Some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. They disagreed among themselves and began to leave after Paul had made this final statement. "The Holy Spirit spoke the truth to your forefathers when he said to Isaiah the prophet, 'Go to this people and say, you'll be ever hearing but never understanding. You'll be ever seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they've closed their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. Therefore I want you to know that God's salvation has been sent to the Gentiles, and they will listen.' For 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. Boldly and without hindrance, he preached the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus." pattern. He tended to go to Israelites first and then to the nations, and he did the same thing here in Rome. As we were reading, he called together the leaders of the Roman Jewish community. They hadn't actually heard anything about his case. They had certainly heard about the sect of the Nazarenes, and they were interested to hear what his opinion was on this group. So Paul was given a hearing, and you can tell how persuasive Paul must have been. The people were, the things they'd heard so far about the early Christians weren't positive. But here was this prisoner who was explaining to them things about how everything in the Pentateuch and in the prophets pointed toward Jesus as the Messiah. And there were, as in other places that Paul went, there were some people who were convinced by what he said. And others who didn't go along with it. Acts says, notice that Paul quoted from Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. And this is an important scripture, it seems like, for the early Christians. It's quoted in the Gospels. And it helped explain to the early Christians what happened as they announced the gospel of the kingdom, that there would be some people who would accept it, other people who wouldn't. And this all, the verses in Isaiah helped explain that this was all part of God's plan, that not all Israel would be responsive, but that would give an opportunity for people from all the nations to come to God. And Paul discusses it, and of course, in his famous olive tree analogy in Romans 11 about how some branches would be broken off, but would be then be grafted back into the olive tree at the end. And so they were able to look to the scriptures to understand that everything was going according to God's plan. And so Paul, throughout, he had to wait about 2 years, it looks like, for his trial, and he took every opportunity to talk with them about Jesus and about the kingdom of God. And that's where the book of Acts ends. We don't know exactly why Acts ends right here, and there are different theories on that. It may just be that Luke never had an additional opportunity to write more, that maybe he meant to write more but didn't. It may be that since at this point Paul has reached the goal of coming before the ruler of the world, that this is kind of the climax and a good place to end. There's one theory that the book of Acts, that Luke originally wrote Acts to put together Paul's case for the trial that was coming. So we don't know for sure why the book ends right here. Of course, we're used to endings like this this time of year. Some of our favorite TV series will end a season with a cliffhanger where one or more of the main characters is in great danger, and then we can wait till the following fall and see how everything comes out. This is certainly a cliffhanger ending, but there are materials at our disposal that give an indication of what may well have happened next, and a pretty strong case can be made for a model where Paul is acquitted at his first trial before Nero, and then has a chance to do a little more traveling, is later arrested again in Rome, and then back to what the charges were, and those are stated back at Paul's earlier trial, back in Caesarea before the procurator Felix. Remember, Paul was arrested in Jerusalem during the Pentecost season. People who were there for the festival from Asia Minor and were familiar with what Paul had done in Ephesus accused Paul of bringing some Gentiles beyond the point where Gentiles were allowed to go at the temple. And when that accusation came up, a riot ensued. Paul was going to be basically lynched, but the Romans were able to step in and save him. There were a group of people who, zealots who vowed to not eat again until they killed Paul, and when the Romans found out about that, they whisked him off under cover of night to Caesarea, where he had his first trial. And that's where we are in Acts 24, where the charges are stated. And at that trial, the high priest at that point went to Caesarea with some of the elders and a lawyer named Tertullus. This is Acts 24, verse 1. And they brought their charges against Paul before the governor, Felix. When Paul was called in, Tertullus presented his case before Felix. And Tertullus says, "We've enjoyed a long period of peace under you, and your foresight has brought about reforms in this nation. Everywhere and every way, most excellent Felix, we acknowledge this with profound gratitude. But in order not to weary you further, I would request that you be kind enough to hear us briefly. We found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He's a ringleader of the Nazarene sect, and even tried to desecrate the temple. So we seized him. By examining him yourself, you'll be able to learn the truth about all these charges we're bringing against him." So there are three charges, really. One is that he is someone who had stirred up riots all over the Greco-Roman world, that he was a leader of the Jewish sect of the Nazarenes, a dangerous sect, they said, and was guilty of desecrating the temple. So three main charges. Of those, the first was the most serious. Of course, we know from reading the book of Acts that trouble did seem to follow Paul around on his travels. But this was a charge that would have to be backed up with some evidence. The second part about him being the leader of a particular Jewish sect was not one that Roman officials were as likely to get excited about. And one thing that kind of went in Paul's favor is that a lot of times Roman officials would consider this to be really an argument within the Jewish community and not one that they really needed to be concerned about. The first charge was more serious. They liked to keep order and didn't like people who stirred up trouble. But the second charge, that he was that this particular Jewish sect was one that was dangerous, they were less interested in. And we can see what had happened to Paul elsewhere previously with this kind of charge. If we look back at Acts chapter 18 and verse 12, at this point, Paul is in Corinth, and he's brought before the authorities there. And Acts 18:12 says, "While Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews made a united attack on Paul and brought him into court. This man, they charged, is persuading the people to worship God in ways contrary to the law." Just as Paul was about to speak, Gallio said to the Jews, "If you Jews were making a complaint about some misdemeanor or serious crime, it would be reasonable for me to the Romans did leave it up to their clients in different provinces that they ruled to deal with matters like desecration of a temple, which was a serious charge and could be subject even to a death penalty. But this was something where, again, where you'd have to have some witnesses to make a case. And when Paul makes his defense at the trial before Felix, we'll look back to Acts 24. Paul says in verse 19, "But there's some Jews from the province of Asia, right, who ought to be here before you and bring charges if they have anything against me. Or these who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin. Unless it's this one thing I shouted as I stood in their presence, it's concerning the resurrection of the dead that I'm on trial before you today." So Paul is saying this is really a dispute between the Pharisees and the Sadducees within Judaism that's really at the roots of their accusations. If I've actually desecrated the temple, where are the witnesses who say so? At the end of this, Felix doesn't find evidence sufficient to condemn Paul. He keeps Paul in custody, and the reason, Luke says, is that Felix is hoping that Paul will give him a bribe, and that then he would have been glad to release him. Notice Acts 24, verse 26, "At the same time, he, Felix, was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe, so he sent for him frequently and talked with him," maybe hinting that he could be released for a sufficient sum. Paul, of course, did not want to be released. He'd been wanting to go to Rome, and he was told, he'd been told that he would go before kings, and he was told by Jesus that he would be able to go to Rome. If we look back to Acts 23, preach the gospel to Israel and to the nations in the leading city in the world. And we had evidence that Paul took every advantage of that opportunity. There's some of Paul's epistles that were written during this time. One of those, the Epistle to the Philippians. Let's go there, and we can see some evidence of Paul's activity in Rome and also how Paul was feeling about how this trial might go. So let's go to the Epistle to the Philippians, chapter 1.
Sacrifice and service coming from your faith. I'm glad and rejoice with all of you.
so you too should be glad and rejoice with me. Again, he's not quite sure what will happen. He says, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. And under verse 23, I hope therefore to send him as soon as I see how things go with me, and I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. So again, he's not, of course, not sure how everything will come out, but he has a, an underlying confidence that he's going to be able to come back and see them again. Another epistle that he writes during this imprisonment in Rome is the one to Philemon. And there's an interesting line in that one that indicates Paul's confidence that he will be released this time. And it's verse 22 that I'm thinking about. And Philemon. Okay, so Paul says, and one thing more, prepare a guest room for me, because I hope to be restored to you in answer to your prayers. Paul doesn't know what's going to happen, but he is optimistic that he will be acquitted at this trial. So that's all evidence sort of pointing toward a successful result. Now, of course, there's some other well-known lines in Paul's epistles that where Paul's not so optimistic. The epistles to Philippians and Philemon, Paul writes, he says at the beginning, along with Timothy, and he sends Timothy around to different places. Later on in the epistles to Timothy, of course, he writes to Timothy. So there it's some relevant verses are in chapter 4 of 2 Timothy. So let's go there. In 2 Timothy, in chapter 4, verse 6, we see a different attitude. Paul says, for I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I fought the good fight, I finished the race, I've kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who've longed for his appearing. So when he's writing this epistle to Timothy, it's clear that he's thinking that his death is probably coming up soon. Later on in this chapter, in verse 16 and 17, Paul says, at my first defense, no one came to my support, but everyone deserted me. May it not be held against them. But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was delivered from the lion's mouth. And here, of course, it's not exactly clear which event Paul's referring to. There have been a couple ways, as far as I can tell, that it's been read. One is that to read the first defense as being the first trial before Nero, and have the lion's mouth meaning that this is a deliverance from the emperor. Another possibility is that perhaps this is a first defense of the second trial, an initial defense of the second trial. Either way, seems likely that here this is a later imprisonment during which Paul's writing to Timothy rather than with Timothy, showing a different attitude about what's going to happen. So I think this does seem to fit best with a model where we're talking here about a later imprisonment, Paul having been released after this first one. Alright, so there's some more evidence that would indicate, okay, that there were a couple of trials and that he's released after this first one. There are other biblical sources. One that is very interesting is a document that was written about 30 years or so after this, the Epistle of Clement of Rome to the Corinthians, and this is something you can find in collections of the early church fathers. Clement was a disciple of Peter and Paul, and his Epistle to the Corinthians is very interesting. It's full of biblical references. It reads a lot like one of Paul's epistles. But Clement, in his Epistle to the Corinthians from the 90s AD, if you look in the fifth chapter, Clement says about Paul, after preaching both in the East and the West, he gained the illustrious reputation due to his faith, having taught righteousness to the whole world and come to the extreme limit of the West and suffered martyrdom under the prefects. And the thing that's interesting about this passage is Clement mentioning the extreme limit of the West, because that in the Roman way of thinking would have been over in Spain and Portugal. This is an area that Paul had said, he said in his Epistle to the Romans, that he really wanted to go to Spain. But there isn't any indication in the book of Acts that he would have had any opportunity to have ever gotten there up to this point. So this speaks strongly in favor of Paul being released after his first trial and then gone on to a trip to Spain, the extreme limit of the West, as Clement says. Another historical source that backs up the idea that Paul was acquitted in his first trial is the famous ecclesiastical history by Eusebius of Caesarea. Eusebius was a bishop of Caesarea in the early 300s. Of course, Eusebius has his biases. He's quite a champion of Constantine. But he had access to a wonderful library at Caesarea, including lots of sources that we don't have anymore, that we know about through the references in Eusebius. And, of course, it's an extremely valuable historical source about early Christianity. And Eusebius, chapter 22 of Book 2 of his ecclesiastical history says this. He says, Festus was sent by Nero to be Felix's successor. Under him, Paul, having made his defense, was sent down to Rome. So Eusebius is summarizing what's in Acts so far. Aristarchus was with him, whom he also somewhere in his epistles quite naturally calls his fellow prisoner. That's in Colossians 4, verse 10. And Luke, who wrote the Acts of the Apostles, brought his history to a close at this point after stating that Paul spent two whole years at Rome as a prisoner at large and preached the word of God without restraint. All right, so this is all summarizing what's in the book of Acts. Thus, after he'd made his defense, it said that the apostle was sent out again upon the ministry of preaching, and that upon coming to the same city a second time, he suffered martyrdom. So Eusebius certainly concludes that he was released the first time and there was a second trial later. If you read on in Eusebius, he considers some of the evidence we've been looking at. He looks at 2 Timothy 4 and the indication that there were a couple of different trials. He also mentions the timing of Paul's trial before Nero. This was thought to be in about 62 AD, and it's in the period of Nero's rule before he became known as a persecutor of Christians. There was a big fire in Rome in 64 AD, a couple years later, that, remember, Nero blamed on the Christians and began persecuting Christians pretty actively after that. But at this early point, an earlier point in Nero's rule, he was still to some extent influenced by his advisors, including his tutors from when he was growing up. One of those folks was Seneca, who was a well-known Stoic philosopher and also the brother of Gallio, the guy who had dismissed dismiss the charges against Paul back in Acts 18. So if Seneca is still having some influence on Nero, it may be that that Seneca would spoke in Paul's behalf at Paul's trial before Nero, looking back to Gallio, what Gallio had previously decided, maybe recommending a similar kind of a ruling. Eusebius said, it's probable indeed that as Nero was more disposed to mildness in the beginning, Paul's defense of his doctrine was more easily received. But that when he advanced to the commission of lawless deeds of daring, right, later in Nero's rule, he made the apostles as well as others the subjects of his attacks. So the timing of the trial suggests that Nero may have been more lenient in 62 AD than he would have been later on. All of these things kind of come together to suggest that the cliffhanger at the end of Acts is resolved initially by Paul being able to speak before Nero and being acquitted. After that, what happens? Well, with some of the things we've been discussing, there's some indications Paul apparently went to Spain. From the letters he wrote, he probably got back to visit Philippi, maybe Ephesus, where he'd spent some time, so maybe another travel around the Greek world. Eventually, though, he apparently comes back to Rome at a time probably after that fire in 64 AD, and is arrested again, and this time, as he writes to Timothy, does not have a favorable result. Here's what Eusebius says about that. There are sources that he has access to that give some indication of what happened later. Let's see. So a few chapters later in Ecclesiastical History, the earlier reference was Book 2, Chapter 22, and you go to Book 2, Chapter 25. Here's what Eusebius says. He says, it's therefore recorded that Paul was beheaded in Rome itself, and that Peter likewise was crucified under Nero. This account of Peter and Paul is substantiated by the fact that their names are preserved in the cemeteries of that place, even to the present day. So as far as Eusebius' information goes, later on in the 60s AD, later on in Nero's reign, Peter and Paul are both arrested in Rome and put to death. So even though the Book of Acts ends on a cliffhanger, we have more information to take us further. And of course the story, the book ended, but the story didn't. And we can continue to be inspired by what Paul did, giving his life as an evangelist for Jesus. And we can also be thankful about the fact that that God has called us to be part of this continuing story. And we've had some adventures. Who knows what adventures we'll have going forward? But we do know that God is in control of things, as He was. As you can see, God's guidance all through the Book of Acts. We know we can see God's guidance throughout our lives, and we can be. We can trust that God will bring everything to the conclusion that He has in mind. So on Pentecost, it's inspiring to look at our predecessors and to think about this plan that we're involved in. At this point, I'll turn things back over to Ken.
Well, thanks, Doug. Enjoyed that investigative sermon. I guess that's what we could call it, something like that, a study. And for those of you that don't know, Dr. Ward. He's a professor of mathematics at Miami University there in Oxford, Ohio. And you've been doing that for quite a few years, right, Doug?
That's true. About 28 years now.
28 years.
Time does fly when you're having fun.
Well, that's good. Well, there are many other so-called apocryphal works that carry on this theme of the Acts. I think there are the Acts of Peter, aren't they, or the Acts of some of the other apostles where they try to continue the story. And their value or their canonicity is in debate, of course. But we know this is not the story of what happened in the book of Acts to all the apostles. They all went different directions. The prime focus is on Paul. And like you say, you can see God's hand in his life that's watching over him. But a lot of things, as the future lay out in front of him, he wasn't sure of. He felt this way at one time, felt a little more discouraged at another time, optimistic here, realistic and discouraged maybe somewhere else. But at the same time, Paul was in these situations, his hired house, in prison, whatever. Were there not a lot of people praying for him? A lot of his fellow believers, fellow ministers, people in his congregation that have been praying for him. And yet we know arrayed against him was the minions and principalities and powers of Satan to destroy this nascent church that was growing now and beginning to expand out to crush it. And so there were these forces, this war going on continually. I mean, here Paul got his head cut off, right? Pretty terrible ending. Peter was crucified. And so you think, well, that's kind of a victory for the other side. Well, not until their work had been accomplished. And who knows, maybe like Doug said, Paul did get over to Spain, sow some seeds there, do some other work. And, you know, when there were a lot of people praying for him, God's a dynamic God. He can answer prayer. He can change things. He can open up a door, give him a little bit more time, give him a break. It's like you were discussing, which I thought was very interesting, about the interrelationships between Nero and some of his mentors and tutors and other associates, you know, that were kind of in the periphery involved with Paul's case. And all you need is somebody with little influence to say, well, no, you ought to do this or let him go here or postpone that. And so things happen. And I think in our own lives we've all experienced how sometimes the circumstances look kind of bleak and you wonder how things are going to work out. And yet somehow looking back, they did work out. But that unseen hand of God, often motivated by the pleas of his people, is doing things. And while we can't always see that, we have to have that confidence and that trust that God will see us through. So we march forward. And clearly Paul had that in his heart. Well, we had a break here and a couple of announcements. The next time we'll be seeing each other here in a virtual church, I'll be down in Austin, Texas. And we're looking forward to that, a two-day seminar on the nature of God, the nature of Christ. We've got some new speakers this year, and we're looking forward to it a lot. I'm not looking forward to the traveling. I hate traveling anymore. I used to like it, but I don't like it. It's a big hassle. I kind of like being there, but the going there, it used to be kind of enjoyable, but anymore it's an ordeal, you know, going through the security and crammed in these airplanes. I mean, none of it's pleasant, you know, hauling luggage, that sort of thing, but hey, you do it. Could be worse. We could be going across there on old prairie schooners, old wagons, you know, or walking. So I guess we shouldn't complain too much, right? So 9 o'clock Central Time. Tune in next Saturday and next Sunday. 9 to 5, break for lunch. And that's Central Time. And we hope to have good coverage with both our phone network and also on the web. Looking forward to hearing from Dr. Phil Arnold, an old friend of mine, New Testament scholar, and one who's had a very colorful career and always brings a lot of interesting things to his presentation. So I think you'll enjoy that as well. Also, this would be the time of a service where you normally have an offering, right? Well, we can't do that because of the obvious venue we have here, but three times a year at the special occasions of the Spring Festival, Summer Festival, which is this one, at the beginning of summer, and also the Fall Festival, they brought offerings, and that was part of the celebration, part of the worship services of the celebrations of the Holy Days, and I just want to let you know that we do welcome your offerings, your Holy Day offerings, your Pentecost offerings, given to God and put to the use of the proclamation of the same message Paul was giving. I mean, the very last words there in the book of Acts echo where he was continually preaching about the kingdom of God and the role that Jesus played in making the means of ingress into that kingdom so available, so real. And of course, how is it so real and available? Well, through the resurrection. You know, death no longer is the stopper. But God is going to invite you to live forever is his gift. So feel free to send your offerings in. As you know, the great Shema, where we love God with all of our mind, all of our soul, all of our strength. The Hebrew sages have always understood this whole area of strength, not just, you know, with your muscles, you know, like when you're a young guy, you got a lot of muscles. You go out and use your muscles for God. No, it has to do with your work, the things you do, what you accumulate, the things you have, your wealth. All that's implied in your strength. So loving God with your strength means loving him with your substance that we give to him, as well as our mind and our heart and our energy. And so the offerings are very much a part of how we worship God. And if we don't include that as part of our worship, well, then really we're not worshiping him as he invites us to. You know, we focus on Paul here in the book of Acts, and rightly so. And much of modern Christianity focuses so much on Paul. In fact, he's erroneously given the title of the founder of Christianity, which is utter nonsense. But that's how he's been developing through the Catholic Protestant tradition over the years. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes here, maybe 10. To draw your attention to an article in First Things. I'm holding it up here for you to see. It's, well, you might say it's an intellectual theological journal with a Catholic bent to it. And it was founded by Father John Newhouse years ago. He'd been a Lutheran, converted to a Catholic, as I recall the story. And but it has good material in it, and the editor of First Things, R.R. Reno, is a leading Catholic luminary, intellectual, theological light, as it were. And I came across one of his articles here entitled Loving the Law. You see the title, I'm holding it up there. Loving the Law. Now, there has been a movement away from this idea that Paul was anti-law, or as they would say, antinomian, nomos being the word for law. And And they're moving away from that, and rightly so, because it's not true. You know, the Paul was not anti-law whatsoever. But anyway, in this article, he starts, Christianity has long been susceptible to antinomian temptations. Really? Wow. Well, sure it has. And it's done great damage. St. Paul pointed an often rhetorical, violent rejections of the role of Jewish law in the lives of Jesus' Gentile followers are difficult to untangle. Yeah, well, because it's been tangled and it's been read wrongly. Anyway, he writes, these antinomian, anti-law, you know, against the law, temptations need to be resisted, especially today when an antinomian spirit predominates in our culture at large. Well, it does. An anti-law. Anything goes. There are no standards. There's no list of good and evil, right and wrong. And we should be free to do whatever we want. And this is the new passion of my time. And he goes on to say that moral truths are the foundation of personhood, who we are, and of human freedom. And now they're being compromised in every possible way. But he says, we are children of our antinomian age, one that Christianity itself has played a role in shaping. And a lot of that has to do with anti-Jewish bias. Anti-Semitism has a lot of its roots in that, and how this whole idea of legalism is like, you know, that's it's like using the word racism. You want to put somebody down and say legalism. It's like, oh, he's a racist. Why is he a racist? He writes, to affirm any limiting norms, any moral principles, confessional or creedal standards, things you believe are right and we ought to live by and obey, and even the authority of the Bible, that it's normative, it's the standard by which we live, even to confess that is to fall victim to legalism. You know, sort of the universal solvent to put people down. It's been so much a part of this grace mentality of the Catholic Protestant world. It's a Catholic writing that's here, and he's saying, hey, you know, we bought into too much of this anti-law business. We've misread and confused and tangled Paul up in it, and now we got a whole culture that's full of that, and the church has been, if anything, somewhat complicit in it. And anyway, it's a long article, but I thought I'd draw your word from it. But and he was reading a book on Hebrew Hebrew law and the halakha, and it's from the Hebrew word to derive or to go, the path, following the path of God's law. Did not Jesus give commands? Yeah, he gave commands too. Didn't he? And he said, the words I give you are not my own, but my Father's. And then he gives his commands. And so is that a bad thing? No, it's he shows how actually following commands can bring spirits together, particularly when they're written in our hearts. That is, we've internalized our obedience to that. We become one then with the originator of the command. God himself. There's several other books here on Paul that I'd like to draw people's attention to. One by Pamela Eisenbaum, who is a scholar, a Jewish scholar, but she teaches New Testament, believe it or not. And her book is Paul Was Not a Christian. Now, that's a bit of a shocker, you know, the title of it, but her point is, no, he was thoroughly a God-fearer, and one who, of course, believed in Jesus. And but he was thoroughly a Jew. He stayed a Jew. He stayed in Judaism. But he also was a believer in Jesus Christ and fully committed to him. And his gospel was a building on that. My dear friend Dr. Charles Dorothy developed a theme here years ago, spoke on it, did a number of tapes, some still available, entitled Torah Christ Story, where the Torah means more than just law. It has to do with instruction, wisdom, the path, the way of God. And how that is normative, or the standard, or the way for all of us to walk. And was given by God, and is holy, and is righteous, and is pure. And then we have that Pentecost experience, even though the Bible doesn't say the law came on Pentecost. I don't think there's a Jewish scholar that doesn't believe in the strong tradition that it did. It was in the third month. They were counting. They were following days, weeks. Certain periods of days are mentioned. And they can come pretty close to showing that it had to be at that point in their journey. And the tradition itself is entirely strong and generally accepted by that from Josephus on down. But so here we have the law, the Torah, with instructions given from God on a Pentecost. And then in the New Testament, we have the Christ story. Appended to it. And when the disciples there at this day of Pentecost in the temple, which again was the holy place of God, much like the mountain was, and the pyrotechnic show and everything else was similar to what was happening on Sinai. This time it was in Jerusalem. And this time the spokesmen were 12, the 12 disciples, who then told what had happened. Who Jesus was, about the death, the resurrection, Son of God, and how we can repent if we want to join him. And this is the message of the kingdom of God that Paul then continued to preach. So when you have Torah, Christ story together, you have really the whole message. And basically it's a Pentecost message. Those two Pentecost put together are the package that explain now in a much more real and dynamic sense the kingdom of God. It was certainly spoken of the Old Testament, described in various ways. Messianic kingdom, they looked forward to it. It was the universal time of coming together, the tribes of Israel being reunited, the Gentiles finding out about the God of Israel. All those themes were there. But now it took on specificity through the message of Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection, how, and ascension, how we could actually span the gulf between death and eternal life, and what that required of us. So there's another book on the subject, and this is important because if we have this disconnect that somehow Paul started Christianity and he moved everybody away from the Old Testament, you know, and that's kind of the idea, all this bad law and legalism and yuck, yuck, yuck. It's a total deception, a misreading of Paul. Another fine book here by a scholar from Princeton University, Reinventing Paul, by John Geiger. Excellent book. I'm holding it up here for you. But it's one that I would certainly recommend, you know, that you you look at and you get something from it. And you'll see Paul totally differently. You see how he's making arguments. Sometimes he's using the voice of Adam, actually, in some of his arguments. And people just sort of read over that and say, They read what their preconceptions, what they want him to be saying. And it's a poor way to handle things. But, you know, we have this one word law, which is and the Hebrew Torah, which of course means revelation, teaching, wisdom, as I mentioned, broader notions of instruction. And the English word law is inadequate to convey that. And in the Greek is the word nomos. That's where we get an antinomian, anti-law. And in Latin, the word for laws is lex. But some of these are inadequate to the Torah, which, of course, is the word we're dealing with in the Hebrew and would have been the word in the mind or the concept in the mind of Paul. So what we've tended to do with Paul, I say we, have the scholars down the years, because this is what they wanted to see, you know, anti-Jewish, anti-law, they've drawn these unjustified universal conclusions from some of Paul's particular arguments and circumstances. They tended to universalize it. And they've leaped off the end of the cliff and come to some totally wrong conclusions. And that's what's caused a lot of the difficulty today. But when you look at what God was giving his people at Mount Sinai, it's much more gentle than we think. Sure, there was glory involved that got people's attention. They needed to. They're just coming out of Egypt. They're intimidated by all the glory and power of pyramids and pharaohs and the rest. They need to realize they're dealing with the creator of heaven and earth. And likewise, at the temple, people needed to understand there in Acts 2 that the one to whom the temple was dedicated had something to tell them. And that something was going to be told them with tongues of fire on these 12 spokesmen. They needed to listen. They didn't like all of what they had to hear, but many of them did. Thousands were baptized as a result. So it was entirely effective. But Yahweh's original design was a talking relationship with his people, not a thundering, thumping, you know. Go back to the Garden of Eden. What kind of relationship do you suppose was going on there? And even in the book of Exodus, you find these verbs nicely combining, like listening and obeying, hearing, hear. God wants you to listen to him. Listening to someone's voice is almost, you know, as important as obeying the command. First, you got to listen, right? And God wants you to listen. He wants you to hear him. Hear what he's got to say to you. He's got a lot to say about how we should live, how we should think, how we should love, how we should treat others. That's all part of his instruction. So what Yahweh was seeking was not some sort of a quasi-legal relationship. You know, like he's the cop with the gun, you know, and you got to walk that line, man, or you're going to get blasted. That's not God's way of relationship. It's a father and a son. It's a loving relationship, a guiding one, a nurturing one, a mentoring one. And this whole idea that following God's commands or following his instruction or his Torah somehow is some ugly legalism. There's nothing but a Christian heresy that's been propagated by people who are very antinomian and confused on the subject. And it was a way in which to hide their anti-Semitism in a lot of cases, portraying Judaism as legalistic in order to portray Christ as the answer to legalism and replace it all, get rid of the whole Old Testament, Moses, the whole bunch of it. And now we're kind of free almost to construct a new religion with its new standards. And anyway, they've got it wrong. And all God ever wanted was our inner being to write his law in our hearts and in our minds. And that's what he's doing. And that's what pleases him. And Jesus said, I do all things to please him. And his word is in me. So who was it that really had the Father's laws and words and spirit and character written in him. Well, as our Savior, now he wants us to do the very same thing, and Paul understood that fully. That's why I said, you know, are we against the law? God forbid, he said. So let's try to understand that and understand Paul more fully, and no better time to see that contrast than on the day of Pentecost, where a Torah Christ story come together in one unified message. A message that will lead us to the very side of the very presence of God. For that we can be eternally thankful. Well, that about wraps things up here for today. I'm going to close with a little song here that I like. It's kind of a cute little ditty, you might say. You don't love God if you don't love your neighbor. Rhonda Vincent sings it. A simple message, but it's certainly very, very true. We can get all smart about history and intellectualize one thing and another, but, you know, we don't really go out and practice the love of God. Why, you know, it's a bunch of head knowledge, and that song makes it plain. Well, any final comments you want to make, Doug?
It's just been a joy to get together again. think about what Pentecost is about. It's been great.
I'll give our love to Sherry, and we'll be praying that her body's able to grab the nutrition and be able to handle it so she doesn't get deprived of the essentials. And we also have a long list of other people I mentioned yesterday to be praying for, and I hope all in their prayers remember those that are struggling here and there and different points of life as you have, and know that God does hear. He answers, and he's tender, and the prayer of a righteous man or woman does avail much. So let's remember one another. That's part of the way in which we love one another. Well, Doug, would you lead us in a closing prayer, please?
Absolutely, yeah. Well, Father in heaven, we're so thankful today for two great gifts that that you give us and that you remind us of on Pentecost, the gift of your Torah, our instruction, and the gift of the Spirit. And we know that these precious gifts are worked together as part of a harmonious whole. Thank you for making us a part of the great Torah Christ story. And we were inspired to read about the faithful deeds of the apostles. We look forward to meeting them someday. And we know that as you guided them, you guide us too. And we thank you for that, and we ask you for your guidance. I want to pray especially today that you'll comfort the Hirschberger family in northern Ohio. Want to ask for your protection for Ken and others traveling to the event in Austin next week. Thank you for being with us, for your presence in our lives on this Pentecost and in future. Thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you, Doug, and we're going to close here with if you don't love your neighbor, you don't love God, which makes a lot of sense. See you next week.
There are many people who will say they're Christians, and they live like Christians on the Sabbath day. But come Monday morning till the coming Sunday, they will fight their neighbor all along the way.
Oh, you don't love God.
If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor
and you don't love God.
Matthew, read the 18th chapter in the 21st verse. Jesus plainly tells us that we must have mercy. There's a special warning in the 35th verse.
Oh, you don't love God.
If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble, and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor,
and you
don't love God. If you want salvation in a home on high, if you say you love him while you hate your neighbor, then you don't have religion, you just told a lie.
Oh, you don't love God.
If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble, and you don't try to help him, then you don't love God.
Oh, you don't love God.
If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble, and you don't try.